Welcome to Every Church a Peace Church, a program that promotes the belief that the church could turn the world towards peace if the church lived and taught as Jesus lived and taught. Welcome back. We have a return guest, Father Emmanuel Charles McCarthy, to be with us today for our program. And let me just give you some thoughts and words about just who Father McCarthy is. He's a Catholic priest, and presently he's rector of the St. Gregory Byzantine Catholic Seminary in Boston, Massachusetts. He is a Nobel Peace Prize nominee and co-founder of Pax Christi USA, an international Catholic-led peace organization. He's an author, a scholar. He's written books, The Christian Just War Theory, The Logic of Deceit, a book that's very critical of the just war theory that's often used to permit the violence that is waged around the world. August 9th, another book that discusses the Nagasaki bombing, and a book that I have here, All Things Flee Thee, For Thou Fleest Me, A Cry to the Churches and Their Leaders to Stop Running from the Nonviolent Jesus and His Nonviolent Way. We're going to be talking with Father McCarthy about violence and about faith and the relationship between the two in this program. Father, welcome back to Every Church a Peace Church.
Thank you, Don.
I'm glad to have you here.
Great.
What is the relationship between violence and faith?
All human beings live by faith. Even the atheist lives by faith. Faith is what we believe, but cannot prove by reason. The atheist believes there's no God. That cannot be proved by reason. That's a faith position. The Muslim lives by faith. The Jew lives by faith. The Christian lives by faith. We all live by faith. The great issue is, what's the content of that faith? And what validates that content is true? For the atheist, the only thing that validates the content is true is that he cannot feel confident in a rational argument that God exists. For the Muslim, faith is validated by the teachings of Muhammad. For the Jew, it's Moses. For the Christian, of course, it's Jesus. Faith, then, is our stance, our understanding of what kind of God God is if God exists, and secondarily, what does he expect of people, if anything. Mm-hmm. So, the Jew fundamentally gets his understanding of what kind of God God is and what God expects from Moses. The Muslim from Muhammad and the Christian from Jesus. The relationship between faith and violence is this. Moses and Muhammad are very, very explicit that God justifies and indeed in some cases actually wants people to engage in homicidal violence. Jesus says God, who is made visible in him, rejects violence and enmity. So, it is not enough to say that a person is a person of faith. The question is, what kind of God is his faith in, and what does that God expect consistent with what he is? The relationship between faith and violence differs from religion to religion, faith to faith. Mm-hmm. Our problem in Christianity is, the Jewish person lives and acts consistent with the teaching of Moses. The Muslim lives and acts consistent with the teachings of Muhammad when they engage in violence for whatever purpose, Jews or Muslims. Mm-hmm. The Christian is the incarnational, the enfleshed denial of his own faith when he engages in violence and enmity because the person that he says is God, the ultimate revealer of God's will, Jesus, taught a way of nonviolent love of both friends and enemies. Mm-hmm. So the Muslim and the Jew are functioning utterly consistent with their understanding of God when they engage in violence. The Christian is literally a witness that his faith is wrong, that the one he says is God is wrong when he engages. So therein lies the basic faith violence dynamic, as we could extend it into Buddhism and other religions if we would wish.
Mm-hmm. In your book here, this All Things Flee Thee, For Thou Fleest Me, a cry to the churches and their leaders to stop running from the nonviolent Jesus and his nonviolent way, there's a picture on this cover, and perhaps we'll be able to show that to our audience. What does this represent? What is this picture of? And how does this picture come into play in the discussion of faith and violence?
I found this picture about a year and a half ago when I was researching cover for the book in the National Archives in Washington. It is a picture taken almost immediately after the bombing of Nagasaki. Now, Nagasaki, what you can see in the picture is you see the destroyed Nagasaki Cathedral. Now, the Nagasaki Cathedral was the largest church in all the Orient. The community of Nagasaki, which was around the church, was the largest Christian community in all of Japan. Indeed, it was the foundational community. It was the first Christian community in Japan, was founded by St. Francis Xavier in 1549 at Nagasaki. Mm-hmm. And so Nagasaki was an entirely, in this Urikami section of Nagasaki, it was literally entirely Christian. Mm-hmm. The plane that dropped the bomb on Nagasaki, the boxcar, was led by a Catholic man, Charles Sweeney, had an entirely Christian bomb crew. No Jews, no Muslims, no atheists in the plane. The plane dropped the bomb using the cathedral as the ground zero point. Mm-hmm. And the plane dropped the bomb on the oldest, the original, and the largest Christian community in Japan, devastating the church physically, the physical church, absolutely devastating, and literally wiping out in 9 seconds about 40,000 Christians. The picture is symbolic of what the church has been doing to itself, what the mystical body has been doing to itself since the time that the church, approximately in the 4th century, began to justify homicidal violence and enmity as consistent with the teaching of Jesus. The church has been ripping itself apart. The mystical body has been ripping itself apart. The hands have been pulling out the eyes. The fist have been beating on the ears. We are literally dismembering ourselves. Mm. Yet what we know is that the Last Supper, Jesus' great high priestly prayer, was for unity. Mm-hmm. Jesus' explicit teaching, the only commandment in the New Testament that's unique to Jesus, he gives at the Last Supper. Yes. I give you a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. By this they will know you are my disciples. Mm-hmm. But for 1,700 years, and that's what this picture symbolizes, the church has literally been destroying itself. It's not the Jews have destroyed it. It's not that Muslims have or atheists. Mm-hmm. So that whether it's the picture of Catholics, Christians dropping atomic bombs on Christians in Nagasaki, or whether it's British Christians dropping napalm and firebombs on top of Lutheran Catholic Christians in Cologne and Dresden, or we could go on and on. Huh?
Yes.
It's the same thing. The absolute refusal to identify on the part of the Christian community with the universality, our oneness in Christ, and placing beyond our oneness in Christ, superior to it, our local nationalisms, whether they be American or British or Japanese or whatever the case may be. The consequences have been, of course, that the witness to the world is basically a witness that says, these people do not believe what their leader, what their God says to do.
If we look at the connection between violence and Christianity, it's not difficult. for those who see us from a non-Christian perspective that these people, these people are not following the book. They're not worthy of following the book. Of course, Christ asked us to be the lights. You mentioned the 11th commandment, which is a commandment that we have not elevated, not engraved in stone, and not lived out, that we should love one another, not just our physical neighbor, but love one another, love life, love the Jew, love the Muslim,
the enemy,
love the enemy. Absolutely, love the enemy.
And Don, love how? As Aristotle loved, as Plato loved, as Napoleon loved, as I have loved, as Jesus loves. Mm-hmm. And we know how Jesus loves just by looking at the cross. Mm-hmm. The enemy, he's destroying his life, he's tearing him apart, he's leaving him in anguish and pain to die, and Jesus says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Yes.
Now, that is utterly different, because you know and I know that the normal process that states work by, states that Christians justify in terms of their killing and homicide and enmity, the normal process is not to say, put up your sword, Father, forgive them. The normal process is, when you get the enemy down, kick him in the groin.
Yeah, well, we could not support the military-industrial complex under theories of love and forgiveness and compassion. But it can be supported by demonization and hatred and materialism. And that's where I see, unfortunately, the Christian community supporting, at least a large part, too much of the Christian community supporting that aspect of our existence, and not raising up to contradict it and be active in protest against that type of direction. We, at this point, as I see it, are really at a crossroads. September 11th has changed things, and it's changed things where I believe Christians must become more active, more vocal, more assured that the followings of Jesus require us to stand up against war and violence and hatred and demonization, and a willingness to devote our resources in support of that. We must become the political force that says we can resist evil, but we can't resist it through the use of the gun, through the use of the bomb, the nuclear bomb, the laser guns, or some of the other high-tech, the Predator missiles. We must be able to resist violence in another way. What way would you suggest that Christians of faith resist the evil that is in the world, not only through our own political systems, but elsewhere where there's evil?
Well, I would quote to begin with two people, Martin Luther King Jr. Martin Luther King Jr., several places in his speeches and writings, says, non-cooperation with evil is as important as cooperation with good.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. That is, you cannot, as a Christian, support other people doing evils that you can't do yourself. You know, if you're going out to murder someone and I say, well, you can't murder him, and you say to me, well, give me $5 for the bullets. You know, I can't give you the $5. On the other hand, if I hate someone and I want him killed, but I say, look, I'm a Christian, I can't kill them, and then I hire you as a hitman, I can't do that. Non-cooperation with evil, as Dr. King said, is every bit as important as cooperation with good. And right now, right across the board in the Christian churches, Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox, Evangelical, they are giving maximal cooperation with what Jesus says is evil.
Mm-hmm.
Homicidal violence and enmity are contrary, explicitly contrary to the will of God as revealed by Jesus in the New Testament, mm-hmm. and the original kerygma.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's the first thing. The second thing is, I quote you Origen. Origen was an early father of the church in the first three centuries when the church did not engage in violence and homicide. Not that it didn't do violence and homicide, but it didn't call it good.
Mm-hmm.
There's a difference between committing adultery and calling it good.
Mm-hmm.
And committing adultery and saying, I've sinned. God forgives sin.
Mm-hmm.
But God can't forgive when people don't think evil is evil, they call it good.
Mm-hmm.
So the emperor writes to Constantine. The emperor writes to Origen, rather. It's about 245 AD. And he says, you Christians, you're accepting all the benefits of the empire. And yet you're not fighting. You're not fighting, quote, the barbarians.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm? You're not defending the empire. And Origen says, we do more. He says to the emperor, you don't understand reality. You don't understand what's really real. See, Origen's talking out of the resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
He says,
Origen is the early
one of the
Christian
early fathers of the church. One of the great ones. Huh?
Yes.
Origen says, we do more to defend this empire by our prayers for the people and for its enemies, and by our works of loving kindness towards the people of the empire and the barbarians than you do by all your troops. Well, there's the dynamic. There's the dynamic. Hmm?
Mm-hmm.
When Ronald Reagan was shot, I don't know if you remember, but when he was shot, about 75 people armed to the teeth came out of nowhere to defend him. That's the only way the quote-unquote great public servants of the world can walk the face of the earth. They have to be literally surrounded by armed force.
Mm-hmm.
Mother Teresa walked into situations and all over this world where not even the police would go at night, unarmed with no protection. And the reason is, everyone knows the difference between a governmental public servant, quote unquote, and someone who's really giving their life to serve the poor.
Mm-hmm.
The church is supposed to be taking care of the least off first. There are plenty of people to take care of the wealthy and the middle class. But who's going to take care of the one person every 9 seconds that dies of starvation in this world? The one person every 6 seconds that dies from a disease they could be inoculated against? The least, in other words. Jesus tells us that this is what we're supposed to be about. If we're taking care of the least, not trying to exploit them for their cheap labor and take their minerals from them and so forth like globalization is doing.
Yes.
If we're trying to genuinely take care of them, and we simultaneously not cooperating with the evils of organized violence and enmity, whether they be through the government or media,
mm-hmm.
that's the Christian response to the problem of evil and terrorism in the world.
Yes. And that's where the security lies.
Christianity teaches an utterly new security ethic.
Yes.
The security ethic of the world is arm yourself to the teeth and fight till the last breath and you'll be secure.
Mm-hmm.
The teaching of Jesus is, in this world that's totally perishable, I mean, I perish, you perish, the earth perishes, the United States perishes, the sun perishes, the galaxy perishes. That's a fact.
Mm-hmm.
In a totally perishable universe, there is only one source of security, and that is if God is who Jesus says he is, the Father of all, in all, for all, and above all. If God loves everyone, individually and perpetually forever, that's the security.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what Jesus teaches, God is our Father. But I had a Catholic chaplain tell me, and I know it's true, from the Second World War out in the South Pacific, and he said, when he would say the Our Father with his soldiers out in the South Pacific, British and American, there was not a thought that God was the father of the Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
It never entered their mind. Is God not the father of the Iraqi people?
Mm-hmm.
Are we not as much children of that father? Are they not as much as we are? Of course. So, Jesus comes along and he gives us the ultimate security ethic, which is, God is the Father of all, loves each and every one individually. You are to be merciful as your heavenly Father is merciful. You see, God being the Father of everyone, that's just not a pie in the sky thing. That means, since we are made in the image and likeness of God, since we are children of God, we're supposed to relate to each other as a brother or sister relates to a brother and sister, which is the way the Father wants us to relate.
Yes.
Not killing each other.
No.
No. You know, we produce in this world 4 pounds of food per person per day. 4 pounds a day per person is produced. That's more than enough for everyone to live. Why is there one person dying every 9 seconds? And the reason is not because the Father didn't supply the food.
Mm-hmm.
The reason is because I want to hoard for personal security more than I need, and I'm willing to let other people be destroyed.
Yeah.
But that's living out of a God who isn't the Father. That's living out of a false God, a pagan God.
Mm-hmm.
A great deal of what the churches have done over the last 1,700 years, Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox, and Evangelical, is that they've altered the notion of the fatherhood of God and made it father over a national group, an ethnic group, and therefore, indeed, they love the national group and the ethnic mm-hmm. group, but they're willing to kill the other children of God.
Yes.
There is no security, absolutely no security, in dividing humanity up into those that God loves and those that God doesn't. There's only death.
It even goes to, you know, economic groups, where the middle or upper class have no connection with the homeless, those who are poor, so that they can fend themselves. They're really not the children of God. So, you know, it provides that separation here domestically. And when you extend it to another race or another nationality, there's a greater separation between the notion that God is my own God, not their God. That God does not love them like he loves us or our nation, for example. Our nation is the nation that is pursuing God's will, and other nations that are contrary to that are nations that are not following God's will. That's the dynamic that we see today and through many of the years, unfortunately, where religion has played such a dominant role in the creation and perpetuation of violence and oppression.
One of the great thinkers of the 20th century, a woman by the name of Simone Weil, says, "What is done to the poor in war by bombs is done to the poor in peacetime by the indifference of the middle class and the wealthy.
Mm-hmm.
The poor suffer regardless." Back in Massachusetts, we have a poor black and a poor white section, Roxbury and South Boston. In both of those areas, there's monuments up there, I guess, maybe with 20 or 30 people who died in the Vietnam War. In the richest city in Massachusetts, Dover, there's no monument because no one died.
Mm.
William Buckley, who was out there, you know, supporting the war from the get-go, huh, was simultaneously behind the backs of everyone playing games to make sure his son never was drafted. This is the terrible thing, that all this is not brought to light by the churches.
Yes.
The churches have an obligation to everyone. Now, the obligation to the poor, of course, is indeed that if I'm hungry, you give me to eat, thirsty, you give me to drink. But the obligation to the rich is to tell people that the consequences of someone being hungry and not feeding them are terrible.
Yes.
Terrible. And the churches are not saying that. I have yet to hear a church, I've yet to be in a church, where the pastor has gotten up there and said, this congregation is in danger of perdition. This congregation is in danger of hell's fire because it's dressed too well. How can I afford to buy thousands of new clothes, dollars worth of clothes every year, when other people have to watch their children starve to death? How can I afford to put billions and trillions of dollars into weapons of destruction when other human beings don't even have enough to live? To the extent that the church refuses to teach what Jesus teaches, which is the motto of every peace church, what it falls into is being the religious legitimatizer of secular philosophies that enhance one group's validity in this world over another.
Exactly. If you'd like more information about Reverend McCarthy, let me direct you to the Center for Christian Nonviolence. And the telephone number there is area code 302-235-2925. And you can email at jjcarmody ecapc.org. That's jjcarmody at ecapc.org. And you can get more information about Father McCarthy, get information about his books, look at his readings, or you can just go on any Google site and punch in Emmanuel Charles McCarthy, and you'll get a wealth of information. For 35 years, he has been a proponent of the nonviolent Jesus and an outspoken critic of the church and church leaders that support a notion that we can get along by violence and by domination. Let me again also invite you to look at the Every Church of Peace Church website that we have. That's ecapc.org. And also you can punch in on the search there, Emmanuel Charles McCarthy, and get a lot of information about what Father McCarthy is doing. Father, let's leave this on a hopeful side. What is the hope that we can expect from the Christian church that could lead us closer to the path that Jesus would want us to walk?
The Christian church survives not because of clever administration, not because of money. The Christian church survives because Christ guarantees its survival. Mm-hmm. The fundamental task of the Christian leader, the Christian, is simply to be faithful. If back in 1915, when Albert Einstein thought of the E equals MC squared, if trillions of dollars and millions of man and woman hours weren't put into figuring out how to apply that, we wouldn't be here today. But Jesus' teachings, the Sermon on the Mount, love of enemies, turn the other cheek, the nonviolence, that has not been experimented with and enfleshed. The church is the place where that is to take place to change the world.
Well, thank you, Father McCarthy. I appreciate very much your work, your life, and welcome you all again to join us at Every Church of Peace Church. Seek peace, find peace, be peace. Thank you.
Our back on us. How long will it be till the world can finally see that they turn their back on love? From one to another, it's time to uncover the meaning of it all. So here it is. We are here, 'cause we are family. Living all together, see the shining sea.